Is it now, John?
It is exactly 10 minutes since the last time you asked, darling.
I'm sorry, but it's not like Father to be so late at the diggings. These old tombs give me the shivers.
Well, perhaps he's found something of special interest.
Yes, that canopic jar. He said he'd assemble it.
Darling, I meant something of real interest. Like a beautiful desert maiden.
The only maiden my father's likely to meet would be mummified and at least 3,000 years old.
Yes, well, I suppose that would be too old even for your father. That's better. Can I get you another drink?
Please. Unless you're trying to get me drunk.
What? No, no, not tonight. But I will once we get back to Paris.
When we get back to Paris, I will let you.
Do you promise that?
Annette, my dear. No, John. Leave her.
He did that deliberately.
I'm sure you're wrong. It is not our way to be disrespectful to the dead.
I know all about your ways. Stealing our stores, inciting our labor force to desert us. Oh, yes, you were grateful at first. Till we found the tomb of Ra-Antef. Then you took one look inside and decided you wanted it for yourselves. Now you're trying to frighten us away from here, aren't you?
How dare you speak such accusations? My government and I have given you every possible cooperation.
You've given us no cooperation.
Gentlemen, gentlemen. This is no way to hallow the memory of Professor Dubois. We'll strike camp tomorrow. We're returning to Cairo.
What's that, Sir Charles?
Your work's not finished here yet. For the safety of the treasures and ourselves, we'll complete our tabulations at headquarters.
It seems that your tactics have worked after all, Ashmi. Now we fold our tents and run away.
You cannot run away from the curse of the mummy's tomb. We're all doomed to die for this act of desecration.
You're a fool, Ashmi. If you believe that you can pull the wool over my eyes with these old legends...
It is not wool that obscures your eyes, Mr. Bray, but the lack of vision.
The tomb holds no curses, Ashmi. Only the bones and belongings of an ancient prince. Good can come of this discovery, but not evil. Annette, what is it?
Hussein, you're in down. Hussein, you are too quick. You are your mother's son. Count, that is fine, eh?
All clear your end, John.
Yes, it's all clear here, sir.
Now, gently, now, gently. Ah. Gently. That's it. Well done, Ahmed.
Good.
Well, that's the last. I never thought we'd do it in a week. Everything recorded and accounted for. Oh, Annette, put these somewhere safe, would you please? Well, Sir Giles, you look 5 years younger.
I feel it. We've made archaeological history. We can present to the museum the finest mummified specimen ever known. And treasures from the tomb far beyond our wildest expectations. It's a moment of triumph for you, for me, and for all mankind.
Come in, Ashmi.
We're just going to celebrate. Your government must be very pleased with you.
Perhaps they'll pay for the champagne.
Gentlemen, before you get too full of high spirits, you have a visitor. Your benefactor, Mr. Alexander King.
Mr. King? What, here? Well, this is a surprise. But only fitting that he should be here to join us.
He's in the office.
Here you are, John.
Thank you.
If you'd only learn to play chess, we could make a fortune.
Mr. King, this is a pleasant surprise.
Giles, baby, good to see you. Ask me?
Oh, here, hold this a minute, will you?
Thank you. Got a little present here for you.
Brought it from Constantinople. Turkish candy. Go on, try a bit. You too, old inscrutable. Oh, you too. Go ahead. Take a piece. Want your opinion. That's enough of that. No, 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 no. Oh, oh. What do you think?
It's, delightful.
That's it. Delightful. Delightful. Full of delight. We'll call it Turkish delight.
Well, how are things going?
Well, Mr. King, as you are the financial backer of our expedition, I'm very happy to tell you that Ashmi Bey has obtained a handsome offer from the Cairo Museum.
Mm. How handsome is handsome?
Well, but the complete contents of the tomb of Ra, £70,000.
£70,000? £70,000, do you hear that? You must be out of your mind. Now, I'm going to roadshow this mummy throughout the world. That way we'll make £700,000.
You can't, sir.
What do you mean, can't? Don't tell me I can't. Oh, you kids stick with me. You'll see some real money.
But this is unheard of. Relics of this importance and value cannot be treated as a sideshow. It's blatant sacrilege.
Oh, nothing sacrilegious about making money.
If this is your serious intention and not some form of humor, then I shall be forced to discuss the matter with my superiors.
Well, you go right ahead and do that little thing, buddy boy.
Sir Giles, I trust that your integrity and good taste will finally prevail in this matter. Then there are certain steps I must take. So if you would excuse me, sir.
Bye. they're all alike. Always getting a stew over something. Well, let him check. He'll find out there isn't a cotton-picking thing he can do about it. Now then, let's get down to details. Oh, this is for you.
We open in London on the 3rd of March.
You really are serious?
Well, Sir Giles, like I said, we gotta go where the money is.
But this...
You remember when we opened the tomb? I was standing right beside you. I was as excited as a kid with a double sarsaparilla. You told me we'd made a great discovery for the good of all mankind. Well, who's in a better position to do that good, you or me? You'll put it in some stuffy museum in a one-camel town where nobody will see it except a few tourists on a wet afternoon. I can show it to the world. If people want to be educated, I'll educate them at 10 cents a time.
Mr. King, if you persist in this childish exhibitionism, I shall have no alternative but to withdraw from any further responsibility in this matter.
Oh, now then, who's being childish? Well, hello there. Still having fun, I see.
Hello, Mr. King.
Good to see you again.
Glad to hear you say that. We're going to be seeing a lot of each other from now on.
What do you mean? The job's nearly finished.
Been a slight change in plans. We're all going on to London.
What?
With you in charge.
But wait a minute. Sir Giles is in charge.
He's leaving the buggy right here.
I don't follow.
It's true, John. I've resigned. And in the interests of the expedition, I'd suggest you accept Mr. King's offer.
Yes, but I mean, what's happened?
I think it's better if Mr. King explains it to you.
Okay. Have dinner with me tonight. I'll fill you in. I know a place where we can sample all the local delicacies. See, people enjoying themselves. Oh, we're going to get along fine. You have made up your mind to stick with me on this, haven't you?
Yes, I think so, Mr. King.
And I am very glad. But it is a pity that Sir Giles couldn't see your point of view.
He's living in the past. This is 1900. You have to think modern. What do you two kids plan for the future?
Well, I hope a long life and a happy one together.
You're not worried about the curse of the pharaohs, eh?
Oh, so you know about that, do you?
Know about it. I wish I'd invented it. Anybody that opens a pharaoh's tomb is doomed to die horribly. Hell, there's thousands of dollars worth of free publicity in that. And don't think I'm not going to ballyhoo it in my campaign. Well, as my friend Phineas T. Barnum said, there's one born every minute, and they'll love this. The public love to live dangerously, as long as there's no real danger in it. Say, maybe 10 cents isn't enough.
Effendi. Effendi, I bring urgent message from your master. He says you must come quickly.
Bring a message from whom?
From Sir Gilly. Gilly.
Oh,
Gilly.
I mean Sir Giles.
Well, then we must go. It must be important.
Well, now, wait a minute. I'm going with you.
You ever learn to do that to ragtime, give me a call. We'll make a fortune.
nothing appears to have been broken. And they are obviously searching for something. But what?
If we could answer that question, we'd know who they were. They have not taken gold or jewels that most men would covet.
What's happened, Sir Giles?
Well, the place has been ransacked.
Anything stolen?
No, nothing as far as we can see.
Inspector, sir.
Yes?
I have found something over there.
I suggest, miss, that you stay here.
John! Come here!
What is it, darling?
Your lists have gone.
Lost, and there were no copies. 3 months' work wasted. But why? What possible use could they be to anyone else?
If one wanted to know the complete contents of the tomb, your lists are the quickest way.
And that means we are not the only people interested in the treasures of Ra.
I remember a night just like this, when we were on our way to Egypt.
Yes, I remember it too, darling. Do you realize that was almost a year ago?
That was a happy voyage.
Yes, wasn't it?
But this one?
What do you mean?
I don't quite know, John. But somehow, whenever I'm in proximity to the mummy...
Oh, you needn't worry about him. Safely locked up in the hold, clearly labeled, not wanted on voyage. You know, the only real physical danger you may be in is not from the mummy, but from me.
Don't, John, please.
I'm sorry,
darling. I'm not just being silly. There is something. I feel it. But I just can't explain it.
I'm afraid it wasn't a very good joke, was it? Will you forgive me?
Good night, Sir Giles.
Good evening, my dear. You look very beautiful. Night. Night, John.
That's Giles. You know, Annette, if he carries on like this, he'll soon be as pickled as the mummy.
That's not funny either. This whole business with King has had a deep effect on him. And what's more, the Egyptian authorities have as good as told him he's conducted his last expedition anywhere on their territory.
Yes, I know. It's quite ridiculous. It's King who's to blame, but they probably won't believe him.
What will Sir Giles do?
He may have to retire. He's no longer a youngster.
Oh, that would be a great waste. He knows more about ancient Egypt than any other person.
All right!
That's Sir Giles. You stay there.
John, what happened?
I'm afraid a man attacked Sir Giles.
Is he badly hurt?
No, no, fortunately not. Just a lump on his head and a headache. I'm afraid I got one too.
Was he robbed?
I don't think it was money the man was after.
Oh, I'm sorry. Please let me introduce Adam Beauchamp, John Bray.
How do you know?
How do you know?
If it wasn't money he was after, do you know what it was he wanted?
No, I'm not quite sure.
You think it has something to do with Ra, don't you?
It could have, yes.
You see, both John and I...
My dear, your recent discovery is far too well known to need explanation to me. But surely Sir Giles doesn't keep any of the treasures in his cabin.
Oh, no, no, certainly not. The treasures are in the ship's hold under heavy guard. But certain things have happened which lead me to believe that somebody may be trying to force us to return the treasures to Egypt.
And what are your plans?
Well, we're going to London, where I shall continue my retabulations, and then we shall set up the first exhibition.
Where will you stay?
Well, I booked rooms for Annette and I at a hotel in Bloomsbury.
Well, that's not good enough. I live on my own in a large house in Regent's Park. Why don't you stay with me?
Sorry, that's quite out of the question.
But very kind of you, Adam.
Your work fascinates me. I find you charming people. I've always felt that I should devote more of my time to the arts.
This could be my small beginning.
I wish I could assist your ambitions, Mr. Beauchamp, but I'm afraid we can't alter our plans at this late stage.
But of course you can. Join me for a liqueur and we'll discuss it.
How very nice of you, Adam.
Now, look, really, this is going a little too far.
Not at all.
We've made other arrangements.
Come in, Jessup.
We could all do with a hot toddy to get this blasted English fog out of our throats.
That sounds delicious.
Thank you, Jessup. You look tired, John. I trust this will revive you.
Thank you.
You find them interesting, Annette?
They are so lovely, Adam.
Fabergé is a great artist. This once belonged to the Empress of Russia. I've always felt that it should again belong to a beautiful woman. I would like you to have it.
But, Adam, this is priceless.
It is valueless compared to the pleasure it would give me to think of it in your possession.
Then it would be ungracious of me not to accept. John, look what Adam has given me.
Oh, yes, very pretty, isn't it? May I have another drink, please?
Yes, of course. Annette, some punch?
Thank you, Adam.
Yes, Jessup?
Mrs. Bodie asks, what are your instructions about dinner, sir?
What do you say, Annette? 9 o'clock?
That'll be just right. John?
Oh, I'm so sorry, Annette, but I'm afraid I can't stay. But you do, by all means. You see, the treasures are being delivered this evening, and I promised Mr. King that I'd be there to supervise the uncrating.
Oh, then perhaps I should go along with you. You will forgive us?
Of course, my dear, I understand.
But why don't you come with us?
Well, I'd love to, if you're sure I won't be in the way.
Don't be silly. He won't be, will he, John?
Of course he won't be. But do come, by all means. You're quite welcome.
That's settled, then.
May I propose a toast? To the success of the exhibition of Ra, and may the gods smile down upon our newfound friendship.
All right, the mummy goes in the exact center of that area over there. The exact center, do you understand?
Yes, sir.
Well, start measuring right away.
Yes, Mr. King.
May I have your attention a moment, Mr. King?
Are the footlights ready?
Yes, Mr. King.
Well, then turn them on right away.
It's about the drapes, Mr. King. Whatever you do, don't. Ah! Oh, well, what, sir? I say it's
a beautiful thing, isn't it?
Somebody please get me John Bray.
Yes, Mr.
Right
King.
Away.
Oh, would you like?
Where is the man with the materials?
Would you like something heavier? Yeah.
Come on.
I was just thinking. Where's he gone?
Here, blimey, Fred. Looks just like my wife. I bet you wish he did. I said you'd have to get her a dog license to take her on the street. Ah! No, put it back. Smells funny.
A
These panels from the doors to the gilded shrine depict the major happenings in the life of Ra.
Detail and workmanship are superb.
Mr. Bray, Mr. King wants you.
Well, I suppose he wants me right away.
Yes, sir.
Come here.
A whole lifetime contained in a few pictures.
It's probably more than will be left of our lives. This one shows Ramesses VIII being presented with his twin sons, Ra the elder and B. They grew into two very different persons, both physically and mentally. Ra became a thinker, a searcher for truth and the secret of eternal life. But B, he was a sensualist who spent his time only seeking pleasures for his body.
That is the legend?
Yes, but substantiated in writings and drawings and tales handed down through the ages, which make it fact.
Then please go on. I'd like to hear the rest of the facts.
B was jealous of his elder brother's position and popularity, and suspicious of his profound thinking and deep wisdom. And he continually conspired to have Ra branded as a witch. So successful was he that the aging Ramesses, in an effort to avoid civil war, was forced to accept the will of the people and to banish his favorite son. After months of wandering, Ra and his small band of faithful followers were befriended by an ancient nomadic people deep in a remote part of the Sahara. As time passed, the tribe of nomads became so impressed with Ra's dignity and learning that they asked him to become their king and rule over them. At his coronation, they presented him with a small medallion on which had been inscribed the sacred words of life, used only in the rare ceremony of reviving the dead, a secret which had been in their possession for centuries. Ra then made plans to return to his homeland so that he could set right the wrongs which had been done to him. In preparation, Ra prayed to Bupastis, the most powerful of all his gods, for spiritual guidance on how to use the secret of the words of life wisely, and for the physical strength to carry out his mission. But B, hearing of his brother's plans, sent assassins into the desert to find and kill Ra. He attacked without warning, and showing no mercy, killed nomads and priests alike. As Ra lay dying, they cut off his left hand, on which he wore his rings of birth. They took it back to B as proof that their foul work was done.
They missed the medallion.
What did you say, Adam?
I'm sorry, I was just commenting that the assassins missed the medallion. What happened to it, do you think?
It was almost certainly buried with him in his tomb in the desert.
Was it found amongst the treasures of the tomb?
But...
Well, was it?
No, but perhaps...
So your facts are no more than legend, after all.
Adam, we've got the mummy form coffin in position now. Would you care to see it?
Adam, John said, would you like to see the mummy?
Yes, yes, I would, very much.
Come along, then.
Come on, boys, he wants us to try it once again in there. Come on, these Americans, they're impossible, but never mind, let's do it. And
Fine. Fine, brother.
Well, Mrs. King, I must have your final decision. Velour, lace, or chenille?
Mosquito netting. Aha! There you are. Come on in. Take a look. Yeah? What do you think?
I am very impressed.
Come, will you open the coffin?
Yeah, sure. Want to see what happens?
Fred, what's happening?
They're opening that coffin. Well, they can do it without me.
What about me, too?
He's worth 10 cents of anybody's money.
Mr. King, you are an incredible man.
Well, some of us have got it, and the others ride home in a horse cart.
Jenny, what are you doing?
The young lady mislaid her handkerchief, and I thought she might want it.
Well, you run along to bed now, Jenny. Mr. Beauchamp's given instructions that he's not to be disturbed.
And let's hope the other gentleman doesn't come back and disturb him.
That's enough of that. You run along.
And then, when my mother died, my father went to Paris to lecture at the Museum of Egyptology. It was 6 years before I saw him again.
Why didn't he take you with him?
I was a great disappointment to him.
Why was that?
He always wanted a son.
What a very foolish man.
Yes, but it did work out well. In order to get his love, I studied twice as hard as any son would have. I read everything he wrote and anything else I could lay my hands on, so that by the time I went to Paris, I could converse with him on his own level.
He was surprised?
He was delighted, and insisted I join him as his assistant.
So the story has a happy ending?
Yes. Until that night in the desert.
Well, all that's behind you now. It's the future.
Excellent brandy.
A perfect blend of just the right ingredients. Like that of beauty and intelligence in a woman. But it often disturbs me when women use their intelligence only for academic pursuits.
What would you have us do? Sit at home with our embroidery?
No, my dear, you missed the point entirely. Intelligence can be as gamefully employed in the home as in the academy.
You surprise me, Adam. You're the first man I've met who really understands what a home could mean to a woman.
Doesn't John?
No, not completely. He's prepared to marry me and allow me to continue with my career. But if only he felt as you do.
But you will marry him.
I'm not sure yet.
Then I implore you to be certain before you decide. A wasted life is tragedy enough, but for you to throw away yours on compromise would be doubly tragic.
You are very considerate, Adam.
And you are very beautiful, Annette.
Yes, sir. They're both in the sitting room, sir.
I'm sorry I'm late. I'm afraid Mr. King's new world charm is beginning to wear thin. If he continues to work me as hard as he's doing now, I shall soon be as moribund as the mummy.
Are you very tired? Would you like to eat in your rooms?
Oh, thank you, I have eaten. But, however, I wouldn't say no to a drink if offered one.
Forgive me. Brandy?
Yes, if it's not too much trouble. Annette, what's that? I don't believe I've seen that before.
It's just a medallion.
Just a medallion. Did he give it to you?
No, my father did, the day he died.
May I see that?
Of course.
Is it from the tomb?
No, of course not, John. Do you think my father
it
would
take... It can't be from the tomb. Both the stone and the hieroglyphics are at least 2,000 years older than that. These are early Old Kingdom.
Really? How would you know that?
My interest in your work is not entirely an amateur one, but my studies were of an earlier period than the Egyptian. Here, see for yourself.
I'm sorry, I can't agree with that. I still believe it could be from the tomb.
Let me assure you, Mr. Ray, it is Old Kingdom.
Nobody could be as certain as you are, Mr. Beecham, without extensive examination.
Then why don't you reserve judgment until you have made an extensive examination?
Very well. With your permission, Annette.
I will.
There's only one person I know who has reference books to this period, and that is Sir Giles. I'd like him to see this now. No, he won't be in bed yet. If you'll both forgive me, I'll start straight away.
Jessup will get you a hansom.
Money is to be the yardstick by which the value of education is to be assessed, and I fear for the future. Let's make the redoubtable Mr. King headmaster at Eton, and we're done with it. In 6 months, he'd turn the playing fields into a miniature Coney Island, with each boy a barker on a percentage share of the profits.
Well, at least their arithmetic would have to be good, if only to make sure of getting their fair share. Now, let me see.
And whoever heard of an Egyptologist who wasn't allowed into Egypt? There's no court of appeal, you know.
What page did you say?
That damned Hashmi. I didn't hear him tell the authorities that it was King who was responsible for removing the relics.
Yes, sir. What page?
Oh, sorry, it was somewhere in the 300s, I think.
Thank you.
What do you make of it?
Well, I'm not quite certain, but I think it's... Oh, you clumsy, drunken old...
I see I've now lost your respect, too. You are undoubtedly better left alone to your studies.
I'm sorry, Sir Charles.
Good night, John.
This is not a joking matter, Mr. King. I would have thought the sum of 120,000 English pounds would have wiped the smile even from your face.
It's chicken feed. You seriously expect me to pack up this whole kit and caboodle and ship it back?
My government will gladly accept the responsibility of the transportation charges.
That's more chicken feed. My show is advertised clear across the excited states. Now, you don't want me to disappoint all those little Middle Western people, do you? You know what a circus means to them? It's an outing for the whole family. Day to remember.
It's obvious to me that you are a very difficult man to deal with.
Who, me?
For the last time, I beg of you to accept my government's offer. Then the consequences of the actions you contemplate must rest upon your own head.
Well, then, let the consequences commence. Hiya, beautiful. How do I look?
You'll put Ra to shame.
Gee, I'm sorry John can't be here. How is he?
He's still at Sir Giles's. The doctor wouldn't let him be moved.
A nice kid. Now, who'd want to do a thing like that?
We won't know that until he can tell us. And he hasn't fully regained consciousness yet.
Well, let's hope it'll be soon. Beecham?
King, I see you have all the important press here.
And their friends. Yes, they all show up when they know it's free. Well, if you'll excuse me, I have a show to put on. Hello there. How are you?
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen of the press, this is an historic moment. Today we will open the 3,000-year-old coffin of Ra-Antef, Royal Prince of Egypt. But first of all, I want you to absorb some of the atmosphere, much as it must have been to those intrepid explorers led by my great and good friend, Sir Giles Dalrymple, your premier archaeologist. Our story starts almost 18 months ago to this very day, when he led the expedition, including myself, into the Valley of Kings. The leading member of our team was Professor Eugene Dubois, from the Paris Museum of Egyptology, who unfortunately lost his life at the hands of the superstitious natives only shortly before our work was completed. With him is John Bray, a brilliant young Egyptologist from Cambridge University. The youngest and by far the prettiest member of our team was Annette Dubois, a breath of Parisienne charm that did much to help cool the hot winds of the desert. In addition to being decorative, she was an able personal assistant to her father, the late professor. The guiding light of the expedition was, of course, no, not him, myself. After a short period of relaxation, there followed 10 months of intensive searching and excavation until the discovery of one small stone step overlooked by both searchers and plunderers for countless generations led us to believe that we had found a royal burial tomb. Final feverish excavations allowed us, 6 days later, to be standing on the threshold. Below us were the first great doors, those massive portals to the past. Anubis, the patron of embalming and guardian of the tomb, stood before us. As we entered, the dust of lost centuries filled the air. It was not a thin dust, but a heavy dust, feeling almost as though it contained the textures and sounds of a vanished civilization. It clung to our clothes and cloyed in our nostrils, as if in a last desperate attempt to stop us proceeding. And then, before us, appeared the two statue guardians to the inner tomb.
Mm-hmm.
Here, modern man was confronted with the relics of his ancient Egyptian brothers. Among them were the wardrobe and personal belongings of the royal prince, statues of his gods, funeral furniture, weapons, food. In fact, everything he would need to help and protect him on his journey over the dark waters of death and into eternity. Bupastis stood watching over all, his gaze undimmed. Then, finally, before us stood the magnificently ornate sarcophagus, bearing upon it the molded likeness of the body it contained therein. And now, before the great historic moment, I must take you into my confidence and warn you. There is a curse which says that all persons present at the opening of a pharaoh's coffin and who gaze at the face of the mummy therein shall die, struck down by the wrath of the Egyptian gods. So, any of you of a nervous disposition who wish to leave now may do so. You have been warned. Ladies and gentlemen, for the very first time, and before your very eyes, I will cut the royal seal. Alexander King is very proud to present to you the mummy of the royal prince, Ra-Antef.
Great Scott!
Ask you again, Mr. King. Who would want to steal a mummy?
Who knows? A competitor. Somebody wants to ruin me.
You have enemies, Mr. King?
Of course I've got enemies. I'm in show business. Any one of my friends is an enemy. He threatened me for one tonight.
Is that correct, sir?
Threaten him, Inspector? No. I merely warned him of what might happen.
That the mummy would be stolen.
That is the last thing I would have wanted.
It made his day for him, too.
Now, why would that be, sir?
Because he wants it safely tucked away in some stuffy old museum.
And if that's where it had been, none of this would have happened. Do you mind if I leave now, Inspector? Before this colorful American breaches the English laws of slander.
Yes, that's all right, sir. I think we can all leave now. You'll be hearing from us tomorrow, sir.
Is that all you're gonna do? What about the mummy? He could be out of the country by tomorrow.
I wouldn't worry too much, sir. He'd never get past the customs. Good night, sir. Miss?
Now, just a minute. Look, if you're not good... Well, if that's an English policeman, I should have asked him what time it was and I got more out of him.
Don't you think you should go home and get some rest, Mr.
Rest?
King?
How can I rest? I've got a show with no star.
If there's anything I can do, Mr. King.
Yes, if you want to wrap yourself up in some dirty bandages.
Good night, Mr. King.
Good night. Good night.
Ain't no one here, Gov. They've all just gone.
Did you see Mr. King leave? John, I'm on stage.
Ah,
What are you doing here?
It's true, then.
I want a publicity. I sure got it.
Shouldn't you be in bed?
I think I know why it happened.
Why?
I found out the meaning of the sacred words of life. But they were stolen from me last night.
What's that got to do with it?
I believe someone may have stolen the mummy in order to bring it back to life.
Must have been some wallop on the head.
You don't believe me, do you?
Oh, you're a real sick boy. I'm going to get you a cab.
Look, Mr. King, I can assure you this...
Brad, get Mr. Bray a cab.
He's got one outside, sir.
If someone really wanted revenge, what better instrument to use than the mummy brought back to life?
Sure, sure. Come on.
What better way to cover the real motive but to blame the legend?
Sleep on it, kid. I'll see you in the morning.
You don't want to listen to me, do you, Mr. King?
No, I don't. I've got other troubles. Take him home, cabbie.
Righto, Gov.
Thank you, Richard.
Excuse me, Governor. Did the gentleman say that the mummy may come back to life?
He said it was possible. You don't believe that, do you?
Yes, I do. Them Egyptian gentlemen are always up to some very funny tricks.
Mummy brought back to life. Say, that would really be something.
Can I get you a cab, Gov?
No, I think I'll walk tonight.
Your evening air is so healthy.
Now, there you go.
God bless you, Governor.
Good luck, Gov.
Thank you, Governor.
Good night, Gov.
Half of that's mine, you know. I'll tell you what I'll do. All or nothing on the next hand of cards.
Well, that's very fair. Very fair indeed.
You in a hurry, Gov?
What can I do for you?
Nothing, dearie. I wondered if there was anything I could do for you.
Thanks. But no thanks. Wait. Get a good night's sleep.
God bless you, sir. You're a real gentleman.
I don't know who the hell you are, but don't joke about it.
Bitch in the attic. I had no rent off her for a couple of weeks, neither.
Maybe she did. Come on, you. Finish some of that bread and jam.
Yeah, give him one for me, too, will you? Spoiled
what
do you mean, sir? Decorating the
table?
I don't know when he's well off.
All right,
all right, I'm coming. Here, where do you think you're going, Albert?
I believe you have a foreign gentleman staying here.
And what business is it over yours?
Mr. Bay, an Egyptian gentleman.
Yes, that'll be him on the first floor back.
Thank you, my good woman.
Here, I never said you could go up there, did I?
How much did he give you?
What? You keep your bleeding hands off it.
Be quiet, will you? You've got more tongue than anyone's got trunk. Come on,
you
finish some of that bread and
jam. That's me. Open the door.
Have you found what you're looking for, Mr. Bray?
But your dinner will be ruined, sir.
All right, woman, don't fuss.
And you haven't had a proper meal for days.
I'll be in a minute.
I'll pull the curtains.
Now leave them.
What the devil's that?
There's hieroglyphics on the medallion. A sacred word. No, no. That can't be right. Of life.
We understand each other, Mr. Bray.
Then if what you say is true, who do you think is responsible?
There are more forces at work than even your highly developed scientific mind can grasp.
My dear Ashby, it was for that very reason that I suspected you.
Fool. If I possessed the secret of reviving the dead, do you think I would have misused it in such a stupid way?
No, perhaps not. Then will you come with me to the police?
I shall be happy to cooperate in any attempt to stop further useless killing.
Good, then let's go.
How do I love thee? Let me count the ways. I love thee to the depth and breadth and height my soul can reach when feeling out of sight for the ends of being and ideal grace. I love thee to the level of every day's most quiet need by sun and candlelight. I love thee freely as men strive for right. I love thee purely as they turn from praise. I love thee with a passion put to use in my old griefs and with my childhood's faith. I love thee with a love I seem to lose with my lost saints. I love thee with the breath, smiles, tears of all my life. And if God chooses, I shall but love thee better after death. Darling.
Yes?
I have to leave London.
Oh, no, Adam.
I've made arrangements for you and John to stay on.
Without you, I couldn't bear it.
I want you to come with me, will you?
Yes, Adam, I will.
Tomorrow morning, early.
So soon? How do I tell Joe?
Well, it might be kinder not to while he's ill. I suggest you leave him a note.
I don't like to, but I suppose it's the only way. I'll go and do that now.
Darling, tell me what's happened.
Adam, where's Adam? Is he alive?
Yes, miss. He'll be all right.
Oh, thank God.
Can you tell me what happened, miss?
The mummy, it was here. It's alive.
You actually saw it?
Yes, it attacked Adam.
It attacked Adam?
Why should he do that?
And the theory we brought you, Inspector, has been proved wrong.
That's often the trouble with theories, sir.
May I take Mr. Beecham to his room, sir?
Yes. Sergeant, give him a hand.
And yet you know it's the only theory that works. And yet, of course, it could be that something else has gone wrong. Just could be. Look, Inspector, will you give us another chance to prove that we're right?
There's one advantage the amateur detective has over the professional. A second chance.
Adam, darling, are you all right?
Any luck?
No good at all. More brandy?
Yes, please.
Every solitary reference to the curse agrees that only those directly involved in the opening of the tomb are in mortal danger. What was that?
Curtains. Mighty prince of Egypt, son of the Pharaoh of Pharaohs. Gaze down upon the humblest of thy humble servants, who has transgressed against thee and heaped ridicule upon thy head. May the memory of my ancestors be erased forever, and the memory of my unworthy self remain only in the minds of vermin and the deceased creatures of the earth. I, who have committed the unforgivable and allied myself with desecrators and non-believers, implore thee to destroy my body painfully. And my soul will pay penance through all eternity.
Keep your distance. Find something to cover him up.
Yes, sir.
So our theory was proved right, Inspector.
Yes, it was, sir. Thank heavens.
The mummy only kills those who disturb its peace.
Then that leaves you and Miss Dubois in danger.
I still don't understand. Why should the mummy attack you? It goes against all the known legends.
I think I can answer that for you. No. This way. This way, darling.
I can't believe it. Everything here is in such perfect condition. Oh,
And this. This is a pharaoh's crown.
That has always been mine.
I don't understand.
Sweet Annette, there is much I would have to tell you before you could understand. Think back first to the legend of Ra. Even there are facts you could not know. When Ramesses heard the news of the death of his favorite son, he suffered a stroke, which was finally to kill him. On his deathbed, he sent for the person who had been truly responsible for both of these happenings, and he cursed that person. Cursed him to everlasting life. Unless he could die by the hand of his own brother.
How would you know that?
Because I am that person. B, younger son of Ramesses VIII, Pharaoh of Pharaohs, cursed to eternal wanderings. For I could never die. The only person that could release me from the curse had already been rendered useless by the hands of my own assassin. When your father found the tomb of my brother, he provided the means, but it was lifeless. When you gave us the medallion, you provided the words that would revive it. While the hand of my brother lives, I must use it. So you see, Annette, we will be together as I want it. No. Repeat after me. Awaken, O silent one, thou who hast slept. Say it!
Awaken, O silent one, thou who hast slept.
Appear. Thou art justified against those who sought to harm thee.
Appear, thou art justified against those who...
Osiris, father of all, give this thy servant that which you bestow upon the unborn bird in the egg. Give it the breath of life. Set the time that it may come forth and loudly raise up its voice to praise thee. Awake, O Ra, my brother. Awake, Ra, son of the Pharaoh of Pharaohs. Awake, Ra, prince of the desert. Welcome, my brother. The time is now at hand for you to complete your earthly mission, that you may rest in peace again for all eternity. First, destroy the last of the desecrators.
Adam, stop stopping! You're mad!
Ra, your work must not be defiled by the presence of others.
Come on, John! John, help me! John!
Lead to?
Under the main road, sir.
For God's sake, do something. Right, come on.
Oh.
There.
Stop him, madam. Stop him, please.
My darling, don't be frightened of death.
Welcome it as a release from the torture and torment that is called life.
Oh, I want to live.
That is nothing compared to the pain that I have seen wandering this earth for 3,000 years. Plagues, famine, pestilence, wars, and man's daily inhumanity to his fellow men. That is more cruel, more painful than this mangled stump. Life without end is the only pain I can no longer bear. Nara, now. Kill her! Kill her! My ascetic, beauty-loving brother.
Thank you.